But not only do we is he angry because of our rebellion toward him, he's also angry because of our revelation of him, and we keep on ignoring it. Verse 19 through 20, the problem with man is he continues to suppress the truth about God. And in spite of the fact that God reveals himself in millions of ways, we just keep on ignoring it. And the power of his revelation lies in its scope, in everything that we experience, even in our own bodies. The Bible says that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. You can see God's handprint on even the our DNA and how we are made and how our bodies function. He reveals himself not only in us, but he reveals himself in nature. He reveals himself in the cosmos. When we look up at the moon and the stars in the sky, we can see God's handprints, and we can see his fingerprints all over the cosmos. Psalm 19, we've been reading that psalm this year, says that the heavens declare the glory of God, and firmament show it his handiwork. Day after day of his speech, night after night show it knowledge. He shows himself even when you look up in the sky. You can't look on God's earth anywhere in any direction and not see God's handprint on his creation. He declares himself in the heavens. When you think about it, think about the fact that there are giant telescopes that can view objects that are over 4 billion light years away from us. That's a distance of 25 million septillion miles away. Think about the fact that the earth is 25,000 miles in circumference and weighs 6 septillion, 588 sextillion tons. It hangs on nothing, but it stays right where God put it. It spins at 1,000 miles per hour, and with absolute precision, it moves through space around the sun at 1,000 miles per minute in a yearly orbit that takes 580 billion miles long. Think about the fact that the light from the sun travels at 186,281 miles per second. At this rate, it would take light 125,000 years just to travel across our galaxy, the Milky Way. And the Milky Way is just one galaxy among billions in the universe. Think about all of that, and then imagine how God must feel when the creature that he has made, in order to look at all that he has done and appreciate what God has done and give him acknowledgement and glory and praise, we decide that we have figured out that it wasn't God who made all of that. Now, in fact, all of this stuff just happened by coincidence. That's why it's no stretch of the imagination why the Bible says that the fool has said in his heart that there is no God. But the universe is God's courtroom. And in that courtroom, it proves his existence, and it proves the fact that he has reason to be angry when those of us who have been created by him turn around now and give glory and honor and praise to other things instead of him. If after all this evidence you still reject him, you are without excuse, the Bible says, and guilty before God. Not only is there the rebellion and the revelation of God, that's to keep you too long, there's also the rejection of God. Verse 21 says that we have rejected him, that mankind rejects God. And to reject God after all of the evidence that we see in nature and in the cosmos is a reckless choice. When we're faced with the truth about God and still reject him, that's reckless. But it happens in two ways. First of all, they give God no glory. That's a reckless proposition. When we see all that God has done and still we have a problem we're giving him glory.
Yes, sir.
And giving him praise. It's sinful not to give God glory.
That's right.
Not to give him praise and honor for what he has done and for who he is. I wish I had a witness here. And I believe that it's a sinful thing for Christians to come in the house of God,
well,
knowing all of that God has done for you.
Yeah.
For the Bible tells us that not only did he create this wonderful world and this the cosmos, the beauty of the cosmos, so that we might see it and enjoy it and then give him praise for it, but the Bible says he also saved us, yes, while we were on our way to hell.
Yes, sir.
And then to come in church and then have a problem with giving God praise,
right,
and to give him glory.
Yes,
I think that's a sinful situation.
Yeah.
Not only that, but it also happens with the fact that we won't give God any gratitude.
Right.
And I'm so thankful that my mama taught me when I was a boy that if somebody do something for you,
yeah,
the least you can do every once in a while,
yes,
is say thank you.
Yes.
And so that's why I don't have no problem with it. When I consider all that God has done for me, I don't have any problem with stopping in my daily situation now and getting on my knees and saying, Lord, I thank you for giving me one more day. Are y'all praying with me? Yeah, but not only that, but the resulting condition of the fact that we have rejected God and the fact that we failed to give him glory is that he will allow us, because we have chosen this kind of life, he allows us to have the free will to experience the hollow life that we've chosen. In other words, he has allowed us, because of our own willfulness and our own stubbornness, to choose a life that does not include him.
Wow.
And to choose that kind of life is a hollow life.
That's right.
It means a futile existence. When we think we're living for ourselves, but we're really just wasting our time.
Yes,
I wish I had a witness in here, because all of us have been allotted a certain amount of time in this life.
Yes,
and you might think you're living for yourself and doing what you're big and bad enough to do, but when this life is all over, you'll find that you've wasted your life and wasted your time. It's a hollow life that is without Jesus Christ. It's a hollow life that is lived without acknowledgement and glory and praise to God. But not only that, it's a horrible life, because when this life is over and after all the hell you go through in this life, then to die and then go to hell in the next life, that's just too much hell to have to deal with. But if you live your life without God and without Christ in it, you are living a horrible life that will land you right in the midst of hell. I wish I had a witness. But not only that, but we see, fourthly, there is man's reaction to God.
Yeah.
Not only is this rebellion, but not only is this revelation apparent to us, but the way we react to God causes God to become angry and filled with wrath. I wish I had a witness. He says in verse 22 that we react as fools when we ignore God and we regress into our own a lifestyle and our own agenda that is without God in it. While we think that we are intelligent, but we are just fools when we try to live without God. There are those who are in the world of academia who say that there is no God, trying to tell us that that everything happened just by happenstance. It just happened that way, and just by chance, the cosmos is in its current condition. Just by chance, the earth is placed in the ideal spot that it might sustain life. Just by chance, we have an atmosphere where we can breathe and exist. And just by chance, we are in the place in our solar system that's right in the right spot, so that we're not burned up by the sun, and we don't freeze because we're too far away. We're right in the right spot. And now those who have, by their own imaginations, have determined that this was all done by accident.
Yes, sir.
I wish I had a witness in here. Our reaction to God makes us, those of us who reject him, makes us fools as opposed to intelligent. But not only that, do we react like fools and regress into a lifestyle that is without God, but we react in false religion, because God has made us so that we will worship him. But if you don't worship him, you'll find something else to worship. I'm going to take my seat in a minute, but I want to leave with you this, that if you don't give God glory, you will give somebody glory. If you don't praise and give him thanksgiving, you will give it to somebody else. Well, what are you giving it to, preacher? Well, verse 23 says that we fall into false religions when we reject the true and living God.
Yeah.
That we say no to God, then we turn around and invent other things to worship.
That's right.
And we've got a number of things that we worship in this world.
All right.
Many folk will come to worship their children.
Yeah.
Everybody that's born into that family and shares their gene pool.
Yeah.
It becomes the thing that is in God's place in their lives. In other words, they're first before everybody and everything else.
Right.
Some of us worship our own ability, our ability to do things and to move and to be able to make things happen in the financial world, in the business world, because we have some gifts and talents that folk appreciate. We feel like there is nothing that we can't do.
Yes,
I wish I had a witness.
Yes,
some people just worship themselves.
All right.
It's all about me and what I need and what I want. And I don't care about what nobody else says.
Right.
As long as I get what I want, everything is going to be all right.
All right.
Well, you have become the little G God in your own existence.
Right.
But I'm so glad that there is a big G who sits high and looks low.
Right.
He's the God who has created all things and made us in his image in order that we might give him glory, honor, and praise.
Yeah.
Are y'all praying with me?
Yeah.
Paul says that God is angry because we rejected him.
Yes,
and the way we react to him in order to keep him out of our experience. These are the four reasons why God is angry with sinners. And I'm so glad that the Lord moved on my experience.
Yes,
and so he removed me from God's wrath a long time ago.
Yes,
I'm so glad that before I knew all about his wrath, he got me out of that condition. I heard the preacher praying today. He said, well, my testimony is a little different. I wasn't ever hungry because God always fed me. I wasn't ever naked because he always put clothes on my back. And I'm so glad that I was never in a situation where I understood what God's wrath was all about, where God had already made a means and made a way for me to escape his wrath. By the time I understood that God hated the sinfulness that I was born into, he had already made a way for me to get out of it. I wish I had a witness. In other words, he saved me before I knew what he was saving me from. In other words, he made a way for me before I even knew I was in a situation where I needed a way made. He opened the door before I knew that the door was shut. I wish I had a witness. I'm so glad that he makes a way for those. And I'm remembering as I look back over my life, how God moved in my circumstances to make salvation available before I was even in a situation to know what was in store for me. The Lord didn't scare me in order for me to be saved. He didn't tell me, he didn't show me what hell was all about. I hadn't studied what hell was going to be like and what his wrath was going to be like before he saved me. I just heard that the gospel was being preached, and that there is a man who is able to save those who are lost in somewhere, who died in my place, in order that my sins might be forgiven. And when I heard what Jesus had done for me, I moved through the Holy Spirit to accept his wonderful gift. Is there anybody in here like that? Who before you really knew what hell was all about? God moved you from that experience. He changed your destiny and changed your destination. I'm so glad that I don't have to worry about the wrath of God. Even though God has good reasons in order to be angry at mankind. I'm so glad that in the courtroom of life and in the courtroom of nature, God has made a way for me.